Good afternoon. It's 4:02. I think we can slowly get started. My name is Dmitry Basov. Together with Alex Gaeta, we serve as co-chairs of Columbia Quantum Initiative. And as part of this initiative, we have this lecture series started by Henry Yen. We are absolutely thrilled to have a distinguished speaker today here with us, Professor Nadya Mason. Before I introduce our visitor, I would like to also say that today's event is co-hosted by the physics department. And in physics, we started a lecture series honoring Madame Wu in last year. These lectures are supported in part through generosity of the Wu family. So today, Alex and I actually welcoming you all to two events at the same time. It's a quantum lecture and Wu lecture given by the same distinguished speaker, same room, same hour. It's very efficient. In physics, we really value efficiency. I'm thrilled to see so many students and colleagues and future physicists as well. So that's welcome to this event. Couple of words about Madame Wu. Many of us know her as a legend, maybe as the United States postal stamp, and of course also as a role model for generations of scholars, especially international and female scientists. Others in the physics department know her or knew her as a colleague who gave them career advice early on in their careers. She joined Columbia Physics in late 40s, 1940s, shortly after she was done with the Manhattan Project. And she, at Columbia, she has made groundbreaking contributions to nuclear and particle physics. But that's not all. One of the first publications, these are not my notes, one of the first publications that C.S. Wu has published at Columbia was this short article on quantum entanglement. It's a very nice paper, very short paper, just one page, 600 words, five references, one diagram, no equations. This is kind of my kind of paper I like to read. This work on quantum entanglement of photons was repeated many times and eventually was recognized with 1922 Nobel Prize in physics. So given this quantum contributions of C.S. Wu, Alex and I thought that it would be very appropriate to try to combine two events, quantum lecture and the C.S. Wu lecture, and we were thrilled, absolutely thrilled, when Nadya Mason has accepted our invitation. Nadya recently became dean of the School of Molecular Engineering in Chicago, so she's a little busy, I think. And we were so happy that she carved some time to visit us here. Nadya did her undergraduate studies at Harvard. She did her thesis work in condensed matter, experimental condensed matter physics at Stanford. She worked on a number of very exciting problems in contemporary condensed matter. Through Nadya's work, we understand better how material transitions between two quantum extremes of transport, from complete absence of resistivity in superconductors to complete absence of electrical conduction in insulators, all in one sample, just by tweaking a little bit parameters. And Nadya served on the faculty at the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign for a number of years. She served as the director of the Beckman Institute there. Her discoveries are recognized with many awards, two awards from the American Physical Society. Nadya was elected to American Academy of Arts and Sciences and National Academy of Sciences. Nadia's TED Talk collected 600,000 almost views. And I encourage you all to see this talk. But of course, today we are happy to hear Nadya live in New York, in her hometown, I should add. And please welcome Nadya Mason.
Thank you so much. And you did that without notes, too, so I don't know. That's going to be the most impressive feat of the day. Is this too loud? I feel like I'm yelling. No. Awesome. Okay. Well, thank you again for inviting me here. This is one of my favorite places to visit. I was born in New York. I have my closest family here. So I do love coming back, and I do love visiting Columbia. It's just a great collaborative place where people do fantastic physics. And so it's always a joy to be here. So thank you. I wanted to start by saying a few words about... Am I going to work? Oh, hold on. The meeting's being recorded. This isn't working. It's thinking about it. That's work. A few words about Madame Chen Xiang Wu, because it really is an honor to be able to give a lecture lecture is named after her. Madame Wu, I first really thought about her when I visited Columbia years ago, and I visited Professor Pasupathi's lab. And I believe it was his lab was her former lab. Is he here? Yes. Office. Is it her office? Yeah, your lab is her former office.
No, her office, my office.
Whatever. Okay, sorry. No, it matters. No, because this is what I remember is him bringing me in there and saying, you know, this used to belong to Madame Wu. And then he brought me to the window and he said, that's where she lived. And she used to look through the window of her house and see whether her grad students were in the lab and check at them.
I don't know if this is true, but...
And so, but it stuck with me. I never forgot that because, you know, it just reminds you of what a formidable woman and scientist she must have been to have us years later still talking about her in odd terms, but that's where she lived out the window. But beyond that, you know, since then I've read more about her in her biography, and you know, she's made incredible contributions from Einstein-Podolsky-Rosen to the Manhattan Project, of course, to you know discovering parity violation, for which she obviously should have gotten a Nobel Prize. And you realize in looking at all of her accomplishments that she was at least as, if not more, talented than many of the perhaps more famous scientists of her day, like Fermi and Oppenheimer. Except that as a woman in her field, especially in those days, she had to struggle much more to get to where she was. And in fact, she didn't even have an academic position until I think her first full professorship was here at Columbia much later in her career. And it reminds me a little bit of that quip about Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers, right? that Ginger had to do everything that Fred did, but backwards and in heels. And so, you know, Madame Wu had to accomplish everything. You know, because she was a woman, and despite being a woman, she could accomplish everything. And her legacy is not just her scientific legacy, which is enormous, but also just being a role model for the rest of us, showing, you know, for generations what is really possible if you put your mind to it, if you focus on the science, if you care enough about the work that you're doing. And I really think that, you know, part of her legacy is people like me being here and being able to do science in the way that we do. And even if we still have to do it somewhat backwards and in heels, at least now it's maybe not stilettos, it's like pumps, and they're a lot more comfortable. So for that, I just want to express appreciation for Madame Wu and everything that she did here. So with that, I want to move on to the main topic of my talk, which is... no strain, no gain. So I'm going to talk about strain engineering of two-dimensional materials. And I'm going to give you the punchline first so you can, you know, focus on other things during the talk, look at the pictures. And the main focus that I'm going to talk about is how strain modifies graphene's electronic properties. And I'll talk more about all of these in less technical ways. Our goal was to create global strain to modify the electronic transport in graphene. And we were able to do that on nano-engineered substrates, which showed controllable global strains, strain superlattice gaps, and pseudomagnetic field effects. And I will go on to explain all of this. Okay, so why do we play with strain at all? And by strain, what I mean is you just, you know, you pull something. You pull it, you push it, you compress it, you deform it somehow so that the atoms are moved in some way. So, you know, we can think that of everything electronics has done for us in terms of silicon-based electronics. We have, you know, phones and computers that are, you know, our phones are basically nanocomputers. All of this is silicon-based electronics. Silicon is a brittle material. It's hard to bend. If we want to move on to the next phase of electronics, looking at things like things that conform to our skin, for example, or phones that we can put in our pockets and actually sit on comfortably, or even if we just want to understand the next generation of science, we really want to be able to look at something new that we can do to materials, which is deform them. Right? How do we make new devices by bending materials? What sort of behavior can we get from bending materials? And I saw Dima. If you guys want to move here, I'm not offended if you walk past me. Go ahead. It's fine. Well, totally fine. So to give you an example of what strain can do, I just want to start with the example of strained silicon. So silicon forms a basis of all of our electronics. And yet strain is already built into all of the most modern transistors that we have. And this is an example of Moore's law. Moore's law shows how silicon transistors have gotten smaller over years. And it's, you know, you can see that basically the size of the number of transistors on a chip doubles every, whatever, you know, it follows this line here, right? And so there's a lot of motivation to stay on Moore's law, to keep decreasing the size of transistors so we can put more transistors on each chip. But it gets harder and harder to do that because if you make things smaller and you put large currents across them, you can't turn it on and off anymore, right? If you have too large a current, it's too small, you get leakage currents, you get all sorts of things. And so what Intel did, right, and actually you can see here, this is an example of the earliest transistor. It was about this big. And this is the size of, a modern transistor was of order of 50 nanometers. And so how did Intel beat the end of Moore's law? They added strain to their transistors. And so what they did is added a base of a different material that strained the transistors, led to higher mobility electrons, and allowed them to have larger currents for smaller transistors. And I mentioned this, and it actually changes the bands of the silicon itself and allows you to have these high mobility electrons. And I mention this because if you think that strain is an esoteric knob, it's something that's been used now for years that's actually enabled things like our cell phones right now. Adding strain to these nanoscale materials is why we can continue to have smaller, more powerful electronics, because strain is already being used to engineer things. And so there's a huge motivation to figuring out new ways that we can use strain and that we can make more powerful different sorts of electronic materials and behavior. So we want to make other materials deformable, to bend electronic materials. And you think about how do we do that? And you can think of a simple example. If we have something like a book, right, it's thick, and it's hard to bend a hardcover book. But if you rip a page out, it's very easy to bend that. And so the way to make something deformable is to make it nanoscale. Right? And that's why those transistors, which are so small, are very susceptible to strain. So here, if you just look at mobility is how electrons move through materials versus how hard they are to bend, their bending stiffness. You can start with traditional semiconductor materials. You can see that they have high mobility. These are great electronic materials, but they're really hard to bend. Right? And so what do? Now you can make them into nanowires or membranes, and you can see you can maintain the mobility, and now they're a little bit easier to bend. Now you're making pages out of them, you know, or magazines out of these things. And then you can go all the way down to the two-dimensional limit, right, ripping out just one page of a material, and you can see you can maintain this mobility, but now it's really easy to bend. And so now you can start looking at new classes of materials that you can bend and use in a different way by nanoscaling these things. So now we can say, okay, our goal is to think about these nanomaterials and their interfaces and understand what happens to them when we add these large deformations. And you can see if I look at you, and then you say, okay, we want to understand general nanomaterials, where should we start? And if you look at this graph, there's one easy place to start, and it's a thing that has the highest mobility and the lowest bending stiffness. It's the best electronic material and the easiest to bend, and that's graphene. And to give you a sense of scale of how easy it is to bend this material, the energy it takes to bend graphene is now about the same energy it takes to bend biological materials. And so if you're thinking of incorporating things with, with biology, already graphene is of the same scale as that. So we choose to study graphene and first look at how that changes when it's bent. So for people who haven't probably, who here has heard of graphene? Yeah, okay, almost everyone. Okay, but the reason I still include this, I know everyone's heard of it now, and I heard, but the great, so graphene is you take graphite, which is pencil lead, the reason it slides is that the layers slide against each other, and you take a single layer of that and you get graphene. It's still kind of amazing that graphene even exists, because or any of these 2D materials exist, because they're a single atom thick. It's just one atom. It's the ultimate limit of a thin membrane. And yet it's also the ultimate limit of, a, of an electronic material at that scale. And so graphene really crosses these lines between having a really, really thin material, but also something that has great electronic properties. And so we choose to use this. It's also really easy to make. This is the famous famous Scotch tape method of producing graphene. You know, you start with something like a pencil, right? And the pencil, when you write, the little pieces of graphite spread out, and if you look at the microscale there, you can see there are sheets lying on top of each other. And then you just take a piece of tape and you pull, you, you know, you press it on, you pull it off, and then you take another piece of tape and you pull that on the first, and you keep peeling pieces of tape until eventually what you're left with, you just press onto a substrate and you get something that looks like this, and you see something that you can barely see that's a shadow, and that's a single atomic layer of graphite or graphene. And of course, this won the Nobel Prize, I think 15 years ago, probably the cheapest Nobel Prize ever, because literally it was done with Scotch tape, but one of the most powerful because it introduced this whole new area of purely two-dimensional materials. And I just want to note that now when we make graphene, we actually grow it in a different way, using an oven and high temperatures and a catalyst, and we can form sheets of this. This is graphene grown on copper. And I mention this because most of the experiments I'll talk about were actually grown in a sheet, and then we dissolve the copper and we can just press a sheet of graphene onto what we want to measure. Okay, so graphene has amazing properties. Again, it's, there's a lot of 2D materials. I think graphene still has some of the best. It's thin, it's strong, it can conduct heat really well, it has a high current density. It has a lot of potential applications that people are still looking at and thinking about. This is the only physics-y band structure I'll show here. And I mentioned this, if you look at, I care about electronics. What are the electronic properties of graphene? And you can determine these from looking at how the electrons behave, right? So this is the energy of electrons as a function of momentum. And we live in a really low energy state. It sometimes seems like we're really high energy, but in, if you think about electronics, we're very close to zero energy. And you can see that there are two surfaces that reach a point right here around zero energy. And what this means in terms of measuring the properties of the electrons, the conductivity of the electrons, is that the conductivity follows this kind of linear dispersion around a point. So if you look at the conductivity and you tune the energy of it, you get this thing that's tunable. It has this shape as a function of energy that you apply to the graphene. And this shape is really important because it means that you can change the energy of graphene by applying a voltage to it. Basically, put a battery on it and you can change the energy of this thing. And you know, this means that if you can change the energy with a gate, then you can use it for a device. So this thing is called the Dirac point, this lowest energy point, and this can shift because this has to do with the properties of graphene itself. If you put a molecule on the graphene, then this point will move a little bit and you can tell how many molecules you have. It's like a sensor. Or you can imagine that if you pull the graphene apart a little bit, you also start getting shifts in this point. So this is really good for things like electromechanical and chemical sensing. But even beyond that, we wanted to take a step back and think about, well, what, you know, beyond using this for devices to start, what happens, what really happens to electronic properties when it's strained? When we pull the graphene, how do the electronic properties change? So this has been predicted, and it's predicted that you get really significant changes in the electronics, that you introduce energy gaps, you get large quasi-fields, you can have lots of novel flexible devices. And you know, a huge motivator for us with this experiment that was done in Mike Cromie's group at Berkeley some years ago, where they actually just had a surface, and it was supposed to be a flat surface, and they put graphene on it. And then they measured the electron behavior on this thing. And it turned out it wasn't completely flat. It was a platinum surface, and they had little micro blips on the surface. They kind of looked like this. And when they measured what the electrons were doing around this little micro blip, or nano blip, they saw the electrons were moving in very fast, tiny orbits around this thing. Okay? Now, usually, if you measure material, the electrons are just sort of scattering around, or if you put a voltage, they move across, but they don't move in orbits. In fact, the only thing that causes electrons to move in orbits like that are large magnetic fields. A large magnetic field causes an electron to move in an orbit. But here it was moving in an orbit with no magnetic field at all, right? And in fact, if you considered what magnetic field would have made the electrons move in such a small orbit, that magnetic field would have been 300 Tesla. Okay? And to give you a sense of scale, like, well, it's really big. Give a sense of scale. A refrigerator magnet is like 0.3? No, how many Tesla? 0.05 Tesla? And what is a refrigerator magnet? It's 0.05 Tesla is like, a magnet that will stick to your fridge. So imagine something that's 300 Tesla. In the lab, if you're really lucky, you can pay $200,000 and get like a 19 Tesla magnet. Right? So 300 Tesla is almost unimaginable. In fact, if you created a magnet this big, it would actually blow up after fractions of a second because it would have so much current going through it, it would be unstable and it would blow up. And yet, just from having graphene that was strained over this little bubble, you could get electron orbits as if they're in a 300 Tesla magnetic field. So this was super exciting. It means that just from straining graphene, you get totally new behavior that hadn't been seen before. And our question was then, could you see this not just locally, but across a whole device? Can we study it in different ways? And I want to mention that the reason, it was actually predicted that you can see these pseudo-magnetic fields just from strain. And in fact, it required strain not just in one direction, but strain in two directions to get these sort of pseudo-fields. And so from some non-uniform strain on graphene, such as you get across this little bubble, you should get these high pseudo-magnetic fields. So you need non-uniform strain to generate this. But again, this was measured very locally. It was a local probe that went just on top of this at a nanometer scale. Now, in my lab, we measure sort of at the device scale with the idea that if you can see something locally, wouldn't it be interesting to use it on a larger scale to see if you can reproduce it, if you can use it for something, or if you can just put probes on either end and measure it electronically as opposed to just locally. And so the question then is, can we engineer this somehow, and can we observe it in global transport? Okay. So we wanted to generate these sort of global pseudo fields, get this sort of strain on a large scale in graphene instead of just on a local little nano bubble. So what we needed to do is we wanted to affect transport, we wanted global fields, so we needed to fine-tune the strain and the shape of the graphene. Okay? And so in some sense, what we really wanted, you can pull graphene, right? These are little dudes pulling graphene, right? And if you had little dudes to pull the graphene in three directions like this, and you could get it in such a way that it, maintained its shape across the whole thing, then you could get these sort of pseudo fields. It turns out that we had big graduate students and not little graphene dudes, so that didn't work so well. So what we realized, instead of actually doing it like this across the whole thing, it might be easier to realize periodic strain on a periodic array of pyramids. And so we could get pseudo-magnetic fields across each of these, and on average, on a large scale, we could see these sort of pseudo-fields. And I mentioned that here in Corey Dean's group, he did a similar thing with nano indentations in an array and was able to see similar things. And just to be a little bit technical about it, it really does matter how big these are. If they're too far apart, then you won't be able, the energy scales to see the changes due to pseudo fields are too big. And if they're too close together, then they overlap with the Dirac point. So we wanted these features to be something like 10 to 100 nanometers, which is pretty small and close together. Okay, so we wanted to control strain globally in this 2D system. But at the time, there weren't a lot of techniques we could use to control the strain. So I will say the very first thing that I did, and this is what a lot of people do when they have an idea about applying something that hasn't been applied before and don't really know what to do, I put an undergraduate student on it. And I told the undergraduate, make a thing and stretch the graphene. And so they made this device, which looks a little bit like a medieval torturer stretching device, except on a very small scale. It just has two clamps, and you put a piece of rubber on it, and you can twist the end and it pulls it apart. And so you can see he hand drew grids on here and then pressed the graphene on and then wanted to see what happened on this. And so you can see this is an atomic force microscope image, but this is the graphene. You don't ignore the dots, but here's a graphene and it starts like this. And when we applied strain, you can see what happened is that it ripped. Okay, so that wasn't that exciting. No one wants to see ripped graphene. It's almost what you'd expect in that case. But then we found something kind of interesting, which is that when we released the strain, the rips almost closed themselves. And we measured the resistance. We found the resistance increased when it ripped, but then went back almost to the same place when we released the rip. And this is not totally expected, because you think if you take something like a pencil and you break it and try to put it back together again, you're not going to have a good connection across those broken pieces. But if you have something flat and you break it apart, there's a much greater overlap edge, and so you can actually get some of the same conducting properties across a graphene even as you rip it and put it back together, which makes it pretty resilient for different sorts of devices where you want to strain the graphene. So that was a really nice sign. It's we're able to sort of make lemonade out of the lemon that we had here. But at the end of the day, we want to avoid cracks. We didn't want the thing to rip, and so this wasn't a great technique to use. So then we thought, okay, let's go to these nano pattern substrates like we talked about before. So here there's a process to making these nano patterns. We started with a substrate, we put copper on it, we etched it into pillars, removed the copper, and then etched it again to make it sharp, put contacts, put the graphene on, patterned the graphene, and ended up with graphene that was suspended on these sharp pyramidal arrays. And you can kind of see what it looks like. Here's the array of nanoscale graphene. You can see here's one of these sharp tips. It's about 100 nanometers at the base and about 20 nanometers at the actual tip. And then here's the graphene that's suspended on it. We chose a region with holes, so you could see the substrate and the graphene itself, which is suspended here. And then here's the pattern for measuring. We put a current across here and measure the voltage across there. Okay, and so this is graphene. We transferred it from the liquid, as I mentioned, and it's pinned and strained at the top of these features, and these features are pretty sharp, and they're suitable for transport measurements. So when you measure the transport, there's another thing. So I said here that the graphene is strained at the peaks of these pyramids, but how do I know that it's strained? I just say that it's strained because it looks like it's strained, but usually that's not good enough to just say something looks strained. So it turns out there's a really nice technique for measuring strain across systems. This is using Raman spectroscopy. So Raman measures basically vibrational modes of molecules. If you have a molecule like graphene, it can vibrate this way or it can kind of vibrate this way, right? But it's just the energy vibrational modes. And then you can use light scattering to measure the energy between these vibrational modes. And you can see the examples of the graphene modes here. And the prominent modes in graphene are D and G and 2D modes. Okay. So it's discovered that if you strain graphene, then these modes shift. And so you can see how much they shift due to strain. But there's a little complication in that if you add, as I mentioned, if you add molecules to the graphene, you can also add charges to it. So it's not just strain, but you can add charges. And these charges also cause these modes to shift. And so what was found is that you could actually differentiate between the shift due to strain and the shift due to what we call doping by adding the charges. And in this case, you expect if you take what's called the G peak, which is this guy, and the 2D peak, then if the ratio of the shift of the 2D peak to the G peak is 2, then that's due to strain. If the ratio of the shift is 0.75, then that's due to doping. So you just have to measure what the shift is and see whether it follows a slope of 2 or a slope of 0.75 to see if you're straining it or doping it. And that's exactly what we did for this. We took our flat graphene, which is here. This is all the Raman spectra for the 2D frequency and the G frequency. And then we have our patterned graphene, where our Raman spectra is here. And you can see that it shifts along this slope, which happens to be exactly the 2 slope for strain. Right? So now we know that by having our graphene pinned on top of these pyramids, it's actually straining the graphene. And what's really nice about it is that we know that we're getting a global effective strain because our spot size is bigger than one individual peak. So even though we measure lots of peaks, we can see lots of strain in the graphene. And in this case, the strain is something like 0.1% that we expect. So again, this is over multiple peaks. We expect it to be much larger at the apex there. And if we measure the transport here, I'm not going to say a lot about these plots, but I just want to point out this is the conductance or the resistance, inverse conductance. The red is for high resistance, the blue is for low resistance, and you can see that this is magnetic fields as a function of applied energy or gate voltage. I just want to point out that you can see very different behavior on the graphene on pillars and the flat graphene. It's clearly very different. So we're seeing some change in transport. And in fact, what we see for the graphene on the pillars is we see that the electrons are confined in these red regions in a way that's consistent with both in generating pseudomagnetic fields and just confining electrons on the pinning sites. And so that was good. We see some sort of confinement on the pillars, and we can simulate that we get this pseudomagnetic field on top of the pyramid. So that's good so far. But the problem is that, you know, these pillars are kind of far apart, so it's kind of hard to determine the difference between, you know, some charge variation, some strain variation. We really wanted things that were closer together in order to really see strain and pseudo field effects. So then what we did next is we decided to put graphene on closely packed nanosphere arrays. And these nanospheres are about 20 nanometers in diameter. And if you remember, the tips of those pyramids were each only 20 nanometers also. So what this is like is like putting the graphene on an array of just the tips of those pyramids. So it's like putting it on a very sharp tip, but a large array of it. So we spin these spheres onto the substrate from solution, and they look sort of like this. We get these puddles of nanospheres several microns wide, and we align the graphene on top. And the diameters can vary between 10 and 100 nanometers. And this is just a molecular dynamic simulation of what it looks like. It doesn't perfectly conform, as you can see, but you get basically some mostly conforms to the spheres there. Okay. And this is a transmission electron microscope image of a cross-section of the actual device. And what you see here is this is a nanosphere, and here's the graphene. And again, you can see the graphene pinning to the top of these nanospheres and being suspended in between. Okay, so we see the graphene pinned at top here, and we expect that the graphene will also be strained just like it was on the previous devices. And so, you know, this technique was exciting for us because we can get these variations on a very small scale, on the 20 nanometer scale, to see electronic changes. It's a simple way to get modulation over a larger range of microns instead of nanometers. You can get very large strain gradients because these nanospheres can be pretty small. And we can also vary the materials. We can have any material for the nanosphere, any material on top. And so it opens up a real breadth of systems that we can now study. And so here's what just an array of the nanospheres looks like. You can see different sizes, 20 nanometer nanospheres, 50, 100, 200. You can see they form these nice close-packed arrays. You know, you can see also as you get smaller, the sizes become a little more irregular, which is why we didn't go smaller than 20 nanometers. But you get these close-packed arrays of the nanospheres, and then if you put graphene on top, you get something that looks like this. And I'd have really... Well, okay, what you can see here is that for the graphene on the 20 nanometer nanospheres looks almost like nothing. That's because it mostly conformally goes over the 20 nanometer spheres. On 50 nanometers, you start seeing little herringbone patterns that become, you know, more distinct shapes in the hundreds that goes into these diamond shapes on the 200 nanometer. These are wrinkles in the graphene. And we just had a really nice discussion about you know, other things that happen in wrinkled graphene, like exciton and emissions. But you can see here these really clear wrinkle patterns that form across the graphene as you get to these larger nanospheres. So wrinkles are really interesting in and of themselves. We ended up not studying the wrinkles themselves, but the fact that we have different, you know, wrinkles forming differently on different sizes of nanospheres also implied that we had different strain for the different sizes of nanospheres. And so you can measure that directly, as I mentioned before, where we just went back to this Raman spectroscopy, and you can see for the flat graphene, we start here, and then for the graphene on 200 nanometer nanospheres, it follows along this line. And again, this is parallel to the strain line. And then for 100 nanometer nanospheres, we get more strain. 50 nanometer, we get more strain. And 20 nanometers, we get even more strain. And so now we can show that we can tune the amount of global strain on the graphene just by putting it on smaller and smaller nanospheres. Okay? And this was predicted by theory with molecular dynamic simulations by one of our collaborators who showed that, you know, if you plot the amount of strain as a function of nanosphere, it increases as you go to smaller nanospheres, and this is consistent with what's expected for theory. And basically, it's consistent with having a larger van der Waals force per unit area for the smaller spheres. It's nice to be consistent, but it's also nice for us to be able to tune the strain in this way. We can ignore this. Okay. So now it turns, now we think, okay, we have the graphene that starts flat. It then conforms on top of these nanospheres. We get pinning sites on top of each of these spheres where you get a maximum of strain, which means if we look across the graphene, we get this array of strain points across this nanospheric graphene system. And now this in itself is interesting because we have periodic strain variation, which means we could have what's called a strain superlattice in the graphene nanosphere system. So what does a superlattice mean? Well, a superlattice is just a long-range periodic potential that modifies electronic band structure. Basically, it adds a secondary lattice. So if you think of the original material as having some lattice arrangement of the atoms, if you add another material that's closely enough connected to it, you get a secondary atomic lattice just from the combination of the two of them. And actually, this was made famous by the combination of graphene and boron nitride. This is probably one of the hottest areas in physics right now, is looking at the combinations of different layers of materials and seeing what sort of lattice structures emerge and seeing all the new physics that emerges from these lattice structures. And one of the early ways of showing electronically what happens to the lattice is that you can see that this is for a superlattice of graphene and boron nitride, and you have the standard Dirac point, and then that's from the graphene lattice, and then you get a secondary Dirac point from the combined superlattice, because it's now another lattice with another Dirac point. So you expect to see these little dips for the combined system. Okay, so we wanted to create a nanoparticle graphene superlattice. Here's the kind of what it looks like. The blue areas are where the nanoparticles are. The dark hexagonal areas are where the graphene is, and we expect to have a lattice that's about this size, 20 nanometers, the size of our nanoparticles. Again, this is the band structure. We expect to see secondary Dirac points due to this superlattice here. And if you think about, where would you see, what does the electronics look like if you have a secondary lattice? So if we have a secondary lattice that's the size of our nanoparticles, about 20 nanometers, you just take the area of this red diamond here, which is 4 times 10 to the 12. And for graphene, you expect to have 4 electrons filling every lattice site there, superlattice site. So if you have 4 electrons for every area here, you expect to see conductance dips at 1 times 10 to the 12. So again, just taking this area and assuming that 4 electrons fill it, we should see our secondary dips at 1 times 10 to the 12. So we measure that in a device that looks kind of like this. Here's an actual image of the device. Here's our gold leads. There are nanoparticles everywhere, but you can see the graphene over the nanoparticles here. And if you zoom in on that, you can see that it's basically a polycrystalline lattice, a couple domains across the device. Okay? And we measure conductance. We see conductance here as a function of gate or energy applied. And you can see the Dirac point. And then you can see additional dips that occur around 1 times 10 to the 12. And so to see it a little easier, we normalize just this high energy region here, so that these are all the same. And when you do that, you can see very clearly that you get clear disruptions in the conductance at, again, 10 to the 12, exactly what you'd expect for superlattice Dirac points. Okay? So this tells us now that we have a superlattice in the graphene, but as we already know, what we're doing to it is straining it with the nanoparticles, not adding charges. So this is not like a twisted graphene, boron nitride, charged superlattice. It's actually a strained superlattice where you can see these secondary points pretty clearly. And again, you can see these dips similar to what was seen before. So this is also pretty exciting that we could control this. And we worked with our theory collaborators to show that, even though we had disorder in our lattice, you should still see the sort of dips we see. It's just if we had less disorder, it would be a little bit sharper. But this could be predicted according to theory. I'll ignore that. And we also showed that when we decrease the temperature and then increase it again. As with many things, if you have something, it's getting dark. As you have something, see, now you can't see my hand motions. That's fine. Don't fall asleep. It's late in the afternoon. if you have something stuck and then you heat it up, usually it becomes a little bit unstuck. And so we expect to release the strain a little bit by heating it up and then cooling it down again. And indeed, we saw that exactly. If we started with our graphene on nanoparticles here, after we heated it up, we saw that the strain was released and went to there. And when we looked at these super lattice dips, we saw that we got a less of a dip after we decreased the strain. So we really know that it was strain that was creating these points. Now, I started all this talking about these large pseudomagnetic fields, and we want to see them on devices, and it was exciting to see, you know, the effect of these huge fields without the magnets actually blowing up. And so I want to turn now a little bit to what we expect for this magnetic field behavior in these sort of strained superlattices, now that we know that we have them. What do we see in this case? So just to take one step and say, what do we expect to see for graphene in a magnetic field? What you expect to see is this thing called a Landau fan diagram. Basically, what this is that you put a magnetic field in the graphene, you get these orbital motions of the electrons, okay? And those orbital motions, the energy of them, depends on both the magnetic field and on the number of electrons that are orbiting, right? So it should disperse with your gate voltage, which tells you the number of electrons, and with the magnetic field. So you get these dispersing lines as you increase magnetic field and gate. Okay, so this is called the fan diagram. And if you add a superlattice now, then basically you get secondary fans. So you have your regular Dirac, your regular fans, and then superlattice fans with a magnetic field. Okay, so what do we see? If we just have flat graphene, and again, we always make control devices, graphene that's on nanoparticles and graphene that's not on nanoparticles. If we just have flat graphene, not on nanoparticles, we basically see just a fan. And this here is just, we get additional smearing because we have to do a lot of processing on our device, so it's a little bit dirty. So this is just smearing due to the processing, but basically it's a clear fan diagram with no strain. And we have a strain device, you can see a clear secondary Dirac point. So again, we get the strained superlattice in the magnetic field from the nanoparticles. What's interesting is if we have something that's in between strain, that's not no strain and not a lot of strain, but something in between, we see both behaviors. We start with basically a secondary Dirac point, and then it merges into a standard fan diagram, a standard Landau fan, around 4 Tesla. And we work with our theory collaborators to try to explain this, and what they showed is that they could simulate exactly this behavior if we had a pseudomagnetic field of around 5 Tesla. So this is the different fields that they estimated, and they could see that they could really model our behavior with a global 5 Tesla pseudomagnetic field. And so now, even in the magnetic field effects, we can see that we have some contribution from external field and some contribution from this pseudomagnetic field. Yes?
What's the strain value that you measured?
We just estimated this from Raman, basically. And actually, it wasn't, and we didn't estimate it locally. So this is a little bit made up based on theory simulations and our estimates. We didn't do local measurements on that. Was that what you're asking? Yeah.
So the model said that you're going to impose about 5 Tesla field, and then you independently measure it
at 2% strain. This was estimated. This is not, it's estimated for this. Perfect, yeah. Okay, but to get to, so there is a question here, and this is one of the problems, is that, you know, here we are estimating strain, and we're estimating pseudomagnetic fields, and we're just looking at two things and comparing them and saying, okay, we think that we have a global pseudomagnetic field, and it fits with our data, but we've never really looked locally at this thing, right? So unless you look locally with the scanning probe in the way that Mike Cromies did years ago and saw these really strong local fields, how do we even know that we have a pseudomagnetic field? And can we corroborate this global behavior that we see with the local behavior that we see? And so in order to do that, we then turn to this, again, looking locally using scanning tunneling microscopy to see if we could measure a local pseudo field, which would then confirm for us that what we were seeing on the global scale was at least consistent with what we saw locally. So to do this, we worked with Vidya Madhavan's group at University of Illinois, where they took a tip and could measure local tunneling spectroscopy on the graphene on the nanospheres. And so this is what a flat region of the graphene looks like. And then if you take a step back a little bit, this is what the graphene on the nanospheres look like. This is a bit different scale than this one. You know, I love this picture because it reminds me, it's a very physical picture of what you'd expect if you put like a blanket over a beach ball. And it's kind of what I think about of graphene over these nanoparticles. It's not exactly right, but it, you know, this is a 20 nanometer scale, so you can't see this with the naked eye, and yet it's somewhat gratifying when you look at spectroscopy to see behavior that you know, has a picture that you'd expect. So here's a nanosphere here, here's a nanosphere here, here's one here, and here's what the graphene looks like topographically over it using STM. And so now we want to know what are the electrons doing here. And the first thing we found is that if we look around the apex of this thing, if we look over the nanosphere, and this is the height of the thing, we can extract pseudomagnetic fields locally that are around 55 Tesla. Okay, so this was good. We see clearly that this is consistent with previous measurements and that we have large local pseudo fields up to 54 Tesla, which then, you know, when we measure over the whole device, are probably averaging out to something that's quite a bit smaller, right? Because it's only really big right there. And so when you average over the device, you get something smaller, but it is locally that we clearly have pseudomagnetic fields due to these nanospheres. But then even more interestingly, we thought, okay, what is the other, you know, what do we see spectroscopically in these different regions, at the peak, in the valleys, in between? And you see really different sorts of behaviors. So in this case, again, if you look at this black curve, right, at the very peak, this is where we see these pseudo-Landau levels, and they should, we know how these change as a function of energy, as root n, so that's how we know that this is where we have these large pseudo-magnetic fields at the apex of the peak. But then if you look at these valley regions here, you get these oscillations. And these oscillations are basically due to confinement of electrons. I showed you oscillations before. Here again, you have electron confinement just due to the pseudo fields. And so this has a different energy. The energy goes as n rather than root n. We believe we have these pseudo field induced potential wells which confine our electrons in this region. And the spacing that we see between these is consistent with this 20 nanometer nanoparticle size that we have. And then we see something else in this red region here, which is like a saddle point between the valleys. We see these split peaks, which we're not sure what they are, to be honest. We see some sort of valley splitting at the saddle point. The splitting changes depending on which way you go across the peak. Okay? But we believe that this is some other physics that's happening in this region here. Okay? And then even more interesting, we see not just what we call integer, you know, if you have these cyclotron orbits, they can happen at integer values, but if you have strong interactions among the electrons in your system, they can also happen at fractional values. And we see clear evidence of these Landau levels that happen at fractional values. So not just 1 and 2, 3, 4, 5, but also at minus 2/3, minus 1/3, 1/3, and 2/3. And this is likely due to some strong interactions due to what we call flat bands, that the strongly interacting system changes the band structure in a way that allows you to see these sort of fractional peaks, which I note should be uniquely stable and even superconducting at low temperature. And so this is something that we're interested in looking at. And you know, this observation of these fractional peaks is something that has been predicted. These sort of flat bands and confinement have been predicted and observed in strained graphene before. So this is not totally out of the ordinary for strained systems. There's a beautiful paper by Eva Andre's group a little while ago that showed these split peaks, which are somewhat similar to what we see, where they see this electron confinement and these split Landau levels. And so we see both of those, but also these fractional Landau levels, all in an engineered superlattice. And so there's ongoing work now to really try to measure, to improve the periodicity and measure this in greater detail using STM and transport measurements. So that's basically the end. That's a whole story. Yeah?
Another question. I missed it. The fractional states were measured also by STM?
There's STM. Yeah, this is STM. This was measured near the peak of the thing. Yeah, it was a different. Yeah, there's a detail there. It wasn't the same graph. Like this was measured in a different place than the spectra I showed you before, because there were different locations that had showed different behaviors. So there's some tricks there, but this is measured at a peak. There's another plot here that I took out because it showed how these persist across the nanosphere. It's not just one location, but as you go across the nanosphere, you can see these there. So, you know, this was a story about just graphene, because it's particularly interesting. It's easy to use. There's nice predictions. We can see pseudo fields. But there's a whole zoo of 2D materials out there. And, you know, if you can globally control strain in graphene, you can globally control it in a whole zoo of 2D materials, whether it's stacked materials or different types of single materials, which really give new functionalities. I mean, this is an old example, but it was a solar funnel that was created by, it was created by just indenting a piece of moly disulfide in one location. And this is applied by an external tip. But you can imagine if you could create an array of these things that were all strained, you could really have a device scale structure now that could be practically useful potentially. And this is just, you know, there's lots and lots of things you can do with strain in nanomaterials. So I talked about changing some of the electronic properties like the pseudo fields, but you can also change their thermal conductivity, their polarization. There's just a lot of potential for controlling strain and integrating it into these 2D materials in different ways. Okay, so with that, I will close. You know, I tried to show how we can, substrate engineering really is an effective way to tune these materials. With graphene on these pyramids and pillars, we see strain arrays, electron confinement, super lattices, pseudo fields, and there's just a lot more physics to study. I'm going to end by thanking my research group who did this, plus the funders. And I'll take any questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Thank you, Nadya. Before we go to questions, I would like to give you a gift on behalf of Columbia Physics. It is a communication device. Very power efficient device. It can sustain some strain. It's also, you know, but it's very functional.
Okay.
You can use it in your dean work and in your research work. And that's it. It's a book of stamps.
The woo stamps. That is excellent. And it works without batteries even.
Yes. It never fails.
These are wonderful. Thank you so much.
Questions, please.
Has everyone seen these? These are fantastic.
Sam?
All right. Yes. Thanks for the nice talk. Just on the note of stacking at the end there, are these substrates conducive for transferring the usual dry transfer heterostructures we make with polymers onto these substrates you've been making? Will they withstand that kind of technique as well?
Yeah. No. We've been working on trying to dry transfer these also, and so they rip more easily when we do this, but it does work. So it can happen, but they rip a little bit more easily is the only problem. But yes. Yeah. The more you can avoid liquids, the better, because you get cleaner things. But in this case, they are a little bit delicate. So we have to do critical point drying and all sorts of, you know, with the liquids. And without the liquids, you know, as you're lifting it up, they have to, because, you know, the way the strain works is that you're just pressing the thing on, and then they have to stick at the tips, maintain their strain as you pull off whatever thing you have on there. And so what are they likely to do, right? They'll either pull off at the strain or they'll rip to release the strain. And so it makes it a little more challenging to get that to work. Whereas with liquids, it has a liquid under it, so it maintains the buoyancy of the graphene, and then you critical point dry, which means you go directly from liquid to vapor, and that allows the liquid to go away and it to maintain the strained underneath. So that's the easiest way to do it, but there are others, yeah.
Other questions?
Hi. Usually, when you put graphene on things rather than boron nitride, it dopes the hell out of it.
And yeah.
I'm kind of amazed that your thing doesn't really dope it. Is there a trick to that?
No. The answer is it does dope it. So he's asking about, you know, do we see like charge changes in these things as we add it? And you can, you know, what you can see here is that it. Where is this thing? So if you look at, here's the flat graphene, right? And you can see the spread, you know, the spread is sort of different strain for the flat graphene, but it's not very spread along what you consider the doping axis. And if you look at the ones on nanoparticles, there's a big spread along the doping axis now. So it is doping it. It's just that we can distinguish the effects of strain from doping. So I think this spread tells you that we're getting a bigger doping effect, but the effect of strain is clearly larger than the doping here. Does that?
Interesting.
Yeah. So it is, but just not. And but the other thing, I didn't go a lot into this, but you know, we worked in some of the. If you look a little, you know, we tried to look a little bit more into the theory of what to expect. Besides the fact that it wasn't the only effect, if you look a little bit more into the theory, you can show that a lot of these charge fluctuations, the charge fluctuations don't lead to a super lattice because of the way the charges are distributed. At least that was our expectation across here, theoretically. So, but yeah.
Can I ask another question?
Go ahead.
So there's an alternative strategy, which is what Corey and Jim have been doing, which is to make holes in the substrate and put things on there.
Yeah.
Why? I'm curious. Why did you choose this way instead of the other way?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Corey Dean's group has done some beautiful, and Jim Hone's done some beautiful works with these nanoholes, and then it's strained around the edges of the nanohole. You know, we kind of stupidly just wanted to make pyramids because we really wanted anisotropic strain to start. And so, and it worked. So I, you know, that there is, you know, so I don't know, just, you know, then by the time we moved to nanoparticles, which are pretty sharp. The other thing is that, you know, the nanoparticles are really close packed, right? So they're it's 20 nanometers next to each other, and I don't know how far apart the holes were. Maybe Corey can say how far apart were your holes.
Those were 30.
Okay. Yeah. So you probably should get similar results, is my guess, right? And so my guess is you get something similar. We just went this route. We also, we have experiments using like magnetic nanoparticles also. So one of the goals was to build up to different functionalities of this. So it wasn't always going to be silicon. It was going to be like magnetic nanoparticles on a topological material. That was one of the ultimate aims, and that you can do with this.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Jim Holm and then Jim Shepard. Yeah. By the way.
Yeah, thank you for this wonderful talk. Did you mention that most of the nanospheres here were polystyrene?
They're silicon oxide.
They are silicon oxide.
Yeah.
Okay.
They're all silicon.
I guess my question is, you had the glass ones that I guess are nominally amorphous, and then you mentioned that you had other harder nanoparticles. And based on what we know about glass surfaces, at the truly nanoscopic landscape, I'd imagine that contacts are actually more like point contacts rather than an even conformal distribution.
Yeah.
I'm wondering if you happen to see any evident differences in behavior when you use harder nanospheres versus the glass point contacts.
I haven't done enough on like the magnetic nanospheres to know to clearly see a difference there. What are the things I want to say here? You know, if you look at the MD simulations, for example, and this is in the way, I can't get that out of the way. If you look at like the, you know, even the MD simulations of this show that it's not, you know, this is kind of how we expect it to look, and this is consistent with what we see from our AFM on the you know 20 nanometers versus 100 nanometers and things like that. So for even though it's not perfectly conformal, it still seems to show similar effects. And actually, what was interesting is that they simulated this, but then when they looked at a strain superlattice, they saw a really clear strain superlattice where you'd expect. So for whatever reason, just because it ends up pinning at the apex, the strain superlattice was a real lattice, independent of the fact that you had random wrinkles and stuff around. So that was one of the motivating factors there. But we haven't compared it to other sorts of nanoparticles, yeah.
I was thinking that hydrostatic pressure might be an interesting way to tune the strain in this. Have you put an undergrad on that problem?
That's a good idea. We haven't done that. I mean, one of the biggest problem with the nanoparticles is that we just press it on, and so we don't have a lot of control over what we end up getting. So you're thinking putting like water, putting something on top, and actually,
or like a pressure cell,
or something like that. Yeah. Yeah, so we haven't done that. I mean, it might be. Yeah, I mean, so right, because you'd expect that in a pressure cell, you'd get more of it to conform possibly, and then it would be strained in a different way on top. And so it would be interesting to do. I mean, I would hope it wouldn't, as long as it didn't rip it, but we haven't done, and I will put an undergrad on it when I get back. It's a good idea.
Questions?
students and all of us would like to ask.
Thank you. So perhaps related to this last question, when you look at this blanket-like shape, is gravity playing any role, or the effect is dominated by van der Waals forces?
I believe it's mostly dominated by van der Waals forces.
So if you were to flip the whole thing upside down, you expect no modification.
So do you mean put the whole thing upside down? Mm-hmm. You mean, but then we don't. We've put nanoparticles on top, and we don't see the same effect because they're not pressed on in the same. You know, we've spun the nanoparticles on top, but then you don't get the. You know, I really think it's a mechanical force to start that strains the graph. You know, that the graphene is draped across these things, basically. When we put the nanoparticles on top of graphene, we don't see any of these effects, for example. Right? We don't see strain when we put the nanoparticles on top. So I don't think it's gravity, but I do think that it somehow has to conform to it. Does that make sense?
And what distinguishes top from bottom is not gravity?
No, I think what distinguishes top from bottom is how... I mean, it's like putting a beach ball on top of a blanket. Right, as opposed
But in that case, it's gravity, no? That shapes.
Yeah, it's a bad example. Then let me think of a different example. It's like putting something. Okay, because it's sticky, right? So if it's not gravity, the reason it sticks to the top is because it has a van der Waals force there.
Yeah.
Right, and then it sticks to every top of the pyramids because of that van der Waals force. Whereas in the bottom, it just doesn't in the same way. But okay, I see what you're saying. I don't know. That's interesting. We definitely don't see it when the graphene is on top, when the nanoparticles are on top of the graphene. And I always assumed it was just a processing thing, that it didn't. I mean, the other thing is, the graphene sticks really well to the substrate, right? So when you have the graphene on a substrate, it's already stuck to the substrate. So there's no reason for it to conform to stick to the nanoparticles. If I had suspended graphene that could move and then put the nanoparticles on top, then it should be symmetric, but when it's on the substrate, you're not going to see the same effect.
Yeah.
That's my guess, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. So we have maybe time for last question. Anyone?
Yeah.
Brian, please go ahead.
Okay, I can speak. I was curious, how far in work is this pseudo-magnetic field? I guess I was curious how far you can take the analogy. Can you do like cyclotron resonance absorption and actually measure the local field by...
You could probably do cyclotron resonance. I mean, I think of it as a vector potential, basically, right? So it's not a spin effect, but it is a true vector potential. There's an A, and that A is real, right? So anything that comes out of a vector potential, you should, because at the end of the day, what you're really doing is in my cartoon picture is adding a phase. Right, so if you think of electron motion as, you know, as probabilities, right? What you're doing is adding phases that make the probability of it going in a circle greater than the probability of it randomly going anywhere else, just because of the way the triangular lattice and the way the strain. That's why you need this asymmetric strain. So there is a real potential there, but there's no spin. So anything that you could get out of a potential, you should be able to see. Anything that requires spin, you shouldn't be able to see. So I think that's. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So resonance, probably, right?
You can measure it that way, potentially.
But you'd have to like vary this. You know, you'd have to somehow, I don't know. You'd have to tune the pseudo field, right? And I don't know. You know, tuning it with strain. Okay, now we're back to this little cell. Okay, good. Then now we have our experiment. Okay, so you put it in the pressure cell and you tune the pseudo field and you do some sort of resonance and you can prove that thing.
On that note,
okay. I have to get back to the lab, right? Thank you.